The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
And hello, and welcome to Open, the one and only show that opens the Bronx and the rest of the world right to you. I'm your host, Daren, Jaime. And today we'll update you what's happening in and around our borough as well as across New York City. Coming up, we'll learn about uterine fibroids, and the American Fibroid Center is offering innovative options for women. Afterwards, we'll discuss the efforts to cut red tape and how it will affect small businesses. Then, we'll meet a company helping people preserve their family heritage. We'll give you some more details a little bit later on in the show. Then also, we'll discuss how the Salvation Army has been dedicated to keeping music and the arts alive for youngsters of all ages. And then finally, we'll speak with co-founders of 5 for 5 Films on what people can expect from this year's upcoming film festival. So stay tuned, because all this and much more is heading your way. Right now, we're officially open. Everyone, I'm Daren Jaime. You are now watching Open, a live program bringing the Bronx and New York City straight to you. We also want to welcome our viewers on Manhattan Neighborhood Network, as Open is being broadcast live simultaneously on the MNN channel. You can stay connected to us also on all of our social media platforms at BronxNet TV. Well, some things have been going on through the past week. We'll take you through a couple of them with our Bronx updates. We start off with state news. New York State Governor Kathy Hochul signed a bill giving adult sexual abuse survivors the right to sue their assailants for decades-old attacks. The governor stated, quote, "To those who thought they got away with a perfect crime, I say to you, your time is up. Your victims will see you in court." The Adult Survivors Act applies to cases involving people who were 18 and older when they were attacked, while the Child Victims Act, passed by the legislature in 2019, applies to cases involving younger people. Survivors have said a look-back window created by the Child Victims Act allowed them to pursue justice against attackers and institutions that protected them, like the Catholic Church. Assemblywoman Linda Rosenthal stated, quote, "They were carrying this heavy burden of not just their own horrible assaults and rapes in many cases, but they were also carrying the burden for the unspoken number of victims out there who have not spoken out." And that's Assemblywoman Linda Rosenthal. In other news, state lawmakers have finalized a deal extending and expanding New York City's speed camera program for 3 years, including keeping them on for 24 hours. The deal is slated to include a 3-year extension of the program, which currently expires on June the 30th. Permitting the city's Department of Transportation to place thousands of speed cameras around schools. After 3 years, the city would have to appeal to Albany again. New York City Mayor Eric Adams said in a statement, quote, "This is a major victory for New Yorkers that will save lives and help stem the tide of traffic violence that has taken too many." Well, that's all the time we have for our Bronx updates. We do have to take a quick break, but we do return because we've got a full show of Open coming up right after this. We'll be right back. and welcome back. As many as 1 in 5 women may have fibroids during their childbearing years. Uterine fibroids are non-cancerous growths developing in the muscle cells in the uterus. American Fibroid Centers are prominent leaders in modern fibroid care and offer innovative options for women. Joining me to tell a little bit more details, we had the chief medical officer at American Fibroid Center, Dr. Elsie Coe, in an interview, and she shared with us the importance of knowing.
But talk to me a little bit about when we talk about uterine fibroids. It's very prevalent. And we talk about 1 in 5. That's a huge number.
Yeah, it's more than people think. And a lot of women, if you're going to see your OBGYN, that's great. If you're seeing your internist, that's great. Because there's a lot of symptoms that these women get that are preventable that people don't realize. And it's more than just taking hormone pills.
Yeah. So let's talk about symptoms. When we talk about the symptoms for uterine fibroids, what are some of the more common symptoms that maybe we're not paying attention to?
Well, the most concerning symptom really is the bleeding, the heavy bleeding that a lot of women have. They tell you that they have to change their pads 8 to 10 times a day. They become anemic because of blood so much that they're weak. And they can't even go to work sometimes. They don't even want to get out of bed. And the only blood work will show that they're very anemic. And sometimes they have to get iron transfusions or even blood transfusions. So the other symptoms have to do with the bulk-like symptoms, because these fibroids can grow really large, almost as if, you know, a woman appears pregnant. So because they might appear pregnant and it's that large, the bulk-like symptoms really push on the organs inside, so they can have problems like with back pain, pelvic pain. It's pushing on the bladder, so they have to go to the bathroom a lot. They feel constipated. They have difficulty with sexual activity. It can be really, really tough on women, and they might not even know they have it.
Yeah. So when we talk about having it, there's also treatment that's available. I know that surgery is an option, but there's also non-surgical options. I'm correct.
Yeah, so I think one of the important reasons why I'm here talking today, I'm very grateful to be on here, is to let women know that there are other options that might not have been shared with you from your physician. And it's a non-surgical option. A lot of women don't want to have surgery. They don't want to have their uterus taken out. And this is a non-surgical way of treating fibroids. It's called uterine fibroid embolization, or UFE. And what that means is it's a minimally invasive procedure. It's a same day outpatient procedure. You don't go to the hospital. And we first see you in consult to talk about it, so you're very comfortable with us and you know exactly what's going to happen. But in a nutshell, it's basically getting a tiny little straw or catheter into the uterine artery from a tiny little incision in the groin that you'll leave with a Band-Aid. And we basically inject some particles to really seal off and close off the blood vessels that are supplying those fibroids. And what's different about it from, let's say, myomectomy, which is where some OBGYNs, some surgeons might go in there and remove one fibroid or two fibroids, but they'll leave the other ones behind, because you can't do surgery on all the fibroids. And a woman, a lot of times, have multiple fibroids throughout the uterus. And what the uterine fibroid embolization is different is that it takes care of all the fibroids through a minimally invasive way. I mean, the other alternative to get rid of all of them completely is to take the uterus out.
And when we talk about taking the uterus out, we hear a lot about the word hysterectomy, and you just gave us another term. Can you give us a little bit of the difference between one and the other? Because many people are familiar with the hysterectomy.
Right. So hysterectomy, first of all, it can be done through the abdomen, or it can be done through the cervix. A lot of people don't know about that. It's a major surgery, and you're going to be out of commission for a couple of weeks. You're going to be hospitalized for that. The myomectomy is less invasive, because a lot of times it's done laparoscopically, which means they go with a camera and you might have 3 holes. They have to inflate air into the belly so they can see what they're doing. It is more invasive still than the uterine fibroid embolization. The recovery is much easier. you can also have fibroids that go inside the uterine canal, and sometimes they might do what's called hysteroscopy, which is where they put in a camera through the cervix, through the vagina, and remove the fibroid that way. So again, those are just piecemeal, removing pieces of the fibroid, just one or two at a time, or maybe three. The uterine fibroid embolization is a tiny incision in the groin and basically closing off the blood supply to those fibroids with a catheter. And you basically, the recovery is much faster. Within 1 week, you can go back to work. Most women, I've seen my sister go through it. I actually went through it with her in the 24-hour period. And we've been, you know, it's been around for so long that we know much better ways of pain control. I've been in practice for almost 20 years, and I've seen such a massive shift in how uterine fibroid embolization was done. Used to be that some women would be, every woman used to be hospitalized overnight. And now more and more people are doing this as an outpatient.
Do you find that there's a tremendous amount of fear when it comes to this? That's why sometimes people are not really coming your way when it comes to really dealing with this, because there are some people who say, listen, you know, I had this, but yet and still I'm comfortable in riding it out.
Definitely. There's a lot of fear of the unknown. That's why I encourage you to reach out, even if you decide not to do it, just come in for a conversation about what's going on with you. If you've, you know, I would definitely say, oh, see your OBGYN. And if you got an MRI, bring your MRI disc or report with you, because that will tell us exactly what needed to be done. We'll also talk about the hysterectomy, the myomectomy, all the alternatives, because we're not here to like force you into anything. We want you to be an informed patient who can make the right decisions for yourself. A lot of people have fear, but one of the top reasons why people don't come to us is because they don't even know it exists. A lot of OBGYNs are not familiar with it. The American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology has accepted this as an alternative means for treatment of fibroids in 2008. So it's not that the society doesn't accept it, it's that a lot of physicians are not cognizant about the procedure, and therefore the patients don't even know.
Yeah. So if someone's watching right now and they're saying, listen, this sounds like, you know, I need to take a step forward and really get connected in going forward with this, what do they go about doing in terms of consultations and getting connected with you?
If you want to speak with somebody through telemedicine and you don't want to wait, that is completely fine. Or you could just wait for the consultation to come in and see us. Either way, just know that the entire team is there. We're ready for you. We know exactly what you need. We do this day in and day out. So because we're so super specialized in what we do, we know how to treat the patients and even afterwards, how to make sure you're comfortable at home. You could have what feels like significant cramps, like, you know, your menstrual cramps. There's variations in what people experience. I've seen my sister go through it and I felt like, oh my God, she didn't even look like she was going through it, because we have you take a cocktail of medications when you get home to make sure you're on top of everything before you feel the pain. Now, I'm not saying you're not going to feel pain like my sister did, but I'm saying that if you follow the instructions that we give to you, and we're going to be so clear on what that is, you're gonna do much better than having a surgical procedure.
Dr. Elsie Coe. Now, for more information, you can visit their website at fibroidexpert.com. Don't go anywhere. We've got more Open coming up right after this. Thank you. welcome back. In recent news, New York City Mayor Eric Adams announced New York City will completely eliminate 30 fines on businesses and reduce about 90 others as part of ongoing efforts to cut red tape. City officials said the changes will save the city more than 200,000 small businesses, a projected $8.9 million a year in penalties. Well, the question is, what does this mean moving forward? Joining us to tell us more details, we've got the executive director of business recovery at the Brooklyn Chamber of Commerce, Mark Caserta. And Mark, thank you for being with us. And as you listen to what the mayor has said and done, give me your thoughts.
Hi, thanks for having me. So it's actually very exciting. I think we've been advocating for reducing fines and getting rid of unnecessary rules and regulations for quite some time. This is a great time to do it. Businesses are trying to recover from the pandemic, and we couldn't be more pleased. I think this is a good step forward.
Yeah. So about 30 different types of fines actually going to be eliminated after the mayor does what he wants to do, and he says that it'll save probably small businesses a projected, $8.9 million a year in penalties. Now, some people say that doesn't sound like a lot of money, but to the average business owner, you say what?
Oh yeah, it's going to make a big difference. We spend a lot of time in business recovery, going door to door, talking to small business owners, and beyond the various struggles they've had with the pandemic, having inspectors come to their door and find something wrong and find them, and then a couple hours later, another inspector coming in for another issue and finding them for that issue, can really drag you down. And actually, when you meet someone who's just had an inspector come by and find them, there's often desperation. Sometimes there's just resignation. Just, this is too much. I've dealt with so much and now I've got to deal with this. And I think you often hear people say, I'm just going to give up. So I think this will make a big difference.
Yeah. You hear a lot about red tape. And when we talk about red tape for businesses, I've talked to business owners and they say when, you're trying to navigate with the city, it's a maze. You hear a whole lot of different complaints coming from business owners with regards to red tape. From your perspective, what's it like trying to navigate when you need to involve the city in what you're doing?
So we find that a lot of small business owners don't know all of the rules and regulations because there are so many of them. They've started a business, they've tried to do what's right, and they've kind of run into a wall and haven't been able to figure out, what the rules actually are until they get fined. So, this coupled with some more education and maybe some technology allowing people to figure out what the rules and regulations that apply to them are, will go a long way for sure.
Yeah. One of the city officials was quoted saying that you don't want to give mom and pop businesses, quote, a fighting chance. We know that COVID-19 has had a huge impact on small businesses, particularly those mom and pop shops. How do you see things from your perspective in your lay of the land in Brooklyn?
So the recovery is going fairly well in Brooklyn. I think the state comptroller just said that Brooklyn's recovery is ahead of the rest of the five boroughs. It's doing pretty well. But if you think about all the things that small businesses have been through over the past 2 years, they were closed for several weeks, some for months. Then they were open with a lot of restrictions that made it difficult to do business. They were trying to get grants and loans. A lot of them were unable to do so. There was a labor shortage, supply shortage. Now there's inflation. That's the newest thing that we're hearing in the streets, that things are more expensive than ever, and then customers are slowing down a little bit because they have less money in their pockets. They have high gas prices. Some of them owe back rent after the eviction moratorium is over and are facing potential eviction. So, this sort of thing where you're trying to get rid of the rules and regulations that really just don't make sense anymore and giving them a fighting chance is really critical.
Yeah. I want to go to one of the rules. Businesses will now have 60 days to fix Department of Buildings violations that aren't immediately hazardous. When you look at that particular legislation saying 60 days, give me your thoughts. What do you feel about that? I think that that's a considerable improvement.
Sure, it's a considerable improvement. I would love to see some of these just gotten rid of completely, but giving more time to fix problems is is always a better bet, and letting small businesses have time to cure issues that they're doing wrong is always the right thing. It's not about making money for the city. It's not about punishing. It's just about, you know, safety and about making sure that, you know, people aren't being discriminated against. Those are the things that rules and regulations are for. And when a rule or regulation is necessary, the idea is not to drive them out of business. The idea is to fix the problem and everybody move on. So I think that's the right thing to do.
Yeah. What can we see coming up in the future? I mean, obviously you see the mayor taking his steps to drastically in terms of saying, listen, I want to make sure the businesses know that we're going to take care of them. And I promise this going into office. Are you satisfied with what you're seeing from the mayor, particularly saying that he wants to take care of businesses and here he goes and he makes this drastic move?
He did, and yes, I think it was a great start. He lived up to his promise. He made it a priority. I know there are other small business changes afoot. I believe there's a small business commission that will be coming out that will look at rules and regulations from a small business owner's perspective. So all of these things are great steps forward. We really need this given everything that I described that the small businesses have been through over the past 2 years.
Yeah. Mark, we got to leave it there, but thank you so much for being with us and sharing a little bit about the small business and giving us some insight. Mark is from the Brooklyn Chamber of Commerce, Mark Caserta. Mm-hmm. And we thank so much, Mark, for being with us and sharing.
Thank you for having me.
All righty. Now, if you want more information, please visit the website, brooklynchamber.com. And then, of course, follow them on Instagram and Twitter at Brooklyn Chamber. We encourage you, please, don't go anywhere. We've got some more show open. We'll be right back right after this.
For you,
BronxNet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College,
at Mercy College,
and coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on BronxNet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at BronxNet.tv.
Learn, engage, inspire. BronxNet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
BronxNet.
Welcome back. Treemily is a company that's focused on creating family trees where customers can design, build, and order trees matching their family's heritage. Now, Treemily aspires to help others explore their ancestry and enjoy genealogy by providing them with an online tool to effortlessly create beautiful family trees. Join me now in sharing more details as the product manager at Treemily, Moish Soloway. And Moish, thank you so much for being with us. And when we talk about connecting families together and the ancestry piece, it's become more and more prevalent amongst our society where people are looking to know more about who they are and where they come from.
Yeah, and first of all, thank you so much for having me. I mean, it's great to talk about Treemily. We spent years putting it together and finally it's out there. You know, one of the things I really love about Treemily is not being a someone that's obsessed with genealogy. You know, there's only that much I can take doing real research. And what I love about Treemily is the fact that it makes genealogy accessible for people like me, because all it takes is literally a couple of names. You throw in the names, you throw in some photos, and boom, you get a beautiful visualization of a family tree. So, you know, Father's Day coming up, grandma's birthday, it's there. So it just makes the whole thing so much more pragmatic. Because ultimately, I think a lot more people there's so many people not focusing in genealogy because it's just associated with a ton of research.
Yeah. So take us through, right? So you've got family trees and you've got what's called the family tree builder. So explain to us what the family tree builder is and what it does.
I think the easiest way to do it is to take you through a history of the company itself. The founder, Asher Halberstam, is somebody who lives in Brooklyn. His father is a Holocaust survivor, and I believe he was a teenager during the Holocaust and then came across to the United States. And as someone that lost the entire family in the war, he really committed himself to genealogy. Now, Asher is someone that was always into arts, and he was doing calligraphy and drawing. And ever since he was a kid, his father told him, listen, you know, my focus in life is genealogy. Can you draw me some beautiful family trees? And that's what he has been doing. So a couple of years ago, he decided that using modern technology, he can actually take that skill, something that he used to do manually for his father, and bring it to all of us. So basically the way Treemily works and the way the tree builder works is people can put in the information that they desire. So let's say if I'm building a tree for my father as a Father's Day gift, so I'll put in his name, mom's name, his parents, her parents, myself, my brother, our families, our kids. And then I can select one of the designs Treemily offers. And we actually have a great pipeline. I think once a month, we'll be putting out new designs. Press a button, booms, I have a whole thing generated for me. I can make adjustments. I can edit names. I can edit pictures. And then you select what you want. You can order a canvas. You can order a print. You can get it framed and have it shipped to you.
So when you talk about the family tree, that requires research. We talked about that a second ago. Some people don't like doing the research, right? But, you know, it is becoming more of, a family hobby, more of the fact that people can now just use this and engage this. Talk to me about this. Using this research as a hobby because, yeah, the trees are growing and the people are wanting more and more information about where they actually came from.
Exactly. And it's such a great way to make gifts meaningful as opposed to, you know, looking for another useless item to buy. You can just create something really personal and have conversations around it. I mean, how do people find out stories about their families? You start talking about, you know, this grandparent, that grandparent, and then you find out things you never heard. So this is definitely a great conversation starter. And when we're talking about genealogy, it doesn't mean going to libraries and digging all the way back. It can all start with taking the oldest family member and asking him or her about what life was like back then, what kind of experiences did their family go through. In reality, it's our family. And then you learn so much about it, about yourself, about, you know, something to pass on to your kids.
Yeah. I was looking at this note. It really stuck out to me. It said global genealogy products and services market was valued about $3 billion in 2019, and it's estimated to reach $8 billion by 2026. So that lets you know that more and more people are actually participating, right?
Yeah, yeah. It might have to do with age. you know, the older you get, the more you start to focus on those things. But I also think, I mean, think about the pandemic. I mean, the pandemic really made a lot of us, start thinking about bigger things in life than just everyday, survival. And knowing who you are is really a quintessential question that's answered through genealogy.
Yeah. Before we go, I got to ask you, Father's Day is coming right around the corner. So you did talk about Father's Day gift ideas. What are some potential Father's Day gift ideas that a person could have when it comes to this?
Well, the best one is just building a really nice family tree for dad. Think about a tree. There's the stem, and then you got the branches and the leaves. So the way our trees are built, the stem would be, dad, or if you want, mom and dad, and then the branches would be their kids, and then the smaller branches and the fruit, or the leaves would be the grandkids. And then you can even add the roots for their parents. So to me, it just sounds like the most meaningful gift you can possibly give on Father's Day.
Well, Moish, thank you so much for joining us and being here. And I think that anybody who wants to know a little bit more about the family can definitely get connected to you. And as we said, the numbers are just, amazing to look at how it, by 2026, expected to reach $8 billion. So thanks much.
Thank you, Darren. Take care.
All righty. Want to let you know now, if you want more information, you can visit the website at Treemily.com. Follow them also on Instagram and Twitter at Treemily Family. And we don't want you to go anywhere because Open is coming back with more show right after this. We are back. The Salvation Army has long believed in the transforming power of music and the arts, both in healing lives and providing life-changing opportunities, especially in the case of young people. Now, more than 200 young people from grade school to high school involved with the Salvation Army Greater New York Division Corps of Music and Creative Arts Programs recently competed in the Star Search Music and Creative Arts Talent Contest. Joining us and sharing more details, we are pleased to have Salvation Army Divisionalist Dance Specialist Nicole Alvarez and member of the Salvation Army Bronx Tremont Corps, Akemy Perez, and welcome both to the show.
Hello, thank you for having us.
Thank you. And so, Nicole, thank you for being with us. And so we got a very special guest with us, but tell us a little bit about the work that Salvation Army is doing in terms of music as well as dance and the arts.
Yes, so my colleagues and I, we are all professional musicians / dancers / drama instructors. And basically what we do is we go to the Salvation Army after school programs and we give them free music classes and free dance classes, anything that has to do really with the arts. And we just basically give them as much of our time and instruction to get these young people to be more involved in the music aspect and the creative aspect of life. And then basically towards the end of the season, we have them compete like a friendly competition against each other just to show off the great deal of work that we've been putting since the very beginning of the year.
So, Akemy, how long have you been with the Bronx Tremont Corps?
I'd say 8 years.
Wow. And so it's my understanding that you also did very well in terms of winning first place for their level 3 dance solo. So what was that like?
It was really amazing. It was a great opportunity that I got to have. I did try and work hard because it was a new level that I tried this year. So it was a good experience.
Yeah. And so I understand that you'll also be performing with your regional corps in Hershey, Pennsylvania a little later on this month. That's going to be a great thing. Nicole, would you see a person like Akemy? I guess this is what it's all about, right?
Yeah, this is what it's all about. Just many students like Akemy, they work really hard for this moment. And Akemy also gets coached by other instructors that have been equipping her to be the dancer that she is today. And so it's just a beautiful time to come together and see our talents grow and our students grow and reach new levels and compete in Hershey.
Yeah. So you got the Star Search, the music and the arts talent contest. When you're out there, what are they looking for?
For me?
Yeah.
What are we? Oh, man. They just want to win. No, I'm just kidding. But I think for the instructors that we personally work with them on a daily basis, it's just to see improvements and to see how engaged they are in expanding their skills and their talents. And just having fun and you know, obviously hoping that the prize is number one, like we all go there and compete to win. But above all things, I think what we really look forward to is seeing how many kids we are able to teach throughout the year and how hard they work collectively and individually as a group of musicians, dancers, artists. And it brings really great joy to see the growth in that period of time and the results that we get from that competition.
Yeah. So, Akemy, after winning first place in this level three dance solo, you now go ahead and you move on. Do you feel a sense of nervousness, anxiety as you get ready for this next competition?
Yes. Major sense of anxiety, you'd say, I guess. But in all, I think that God is beside me, and no matter what happens or the place or anything, the outcome, I think I tried my best, and I did it for God, so it's all good.
And I want to say, Nicole, I didn't know this until I, really did the notes here, that most people don't know the Salvation Army is the number one provider of free or reduced cost creative arts instruction for students of all ages outside of the New York City public school system. That's a pretty huge feat.
That's incredible. Wow, that is pretty incredible and honored to to have been known as that. Yeah, we try. What can I tell you? We go out there and we teach with our heart. We don't know what's going to happen in the future. We don't know if we're creating the biggest musicians. And if we are, amazing. But I think overall, just to give a safe space to the community that we're providing these services for and be opening and willing to work with the kids, make sure that they know that they have options outside of math and reading and science, and explore the creative part in them. And so it really is a joy to have such impact in a community, especially dealing with the arts, because the arts, I believe, is the first thing to go when we're talking about, academically. So I think that being able to provide these services in a community and completely free, truly is a joy to take part of, because it's more than just, trying to make them achieve academically and just open a safe space for them to learn and explore their creative side.
Yeah. Nicole, you're spot on. I mean, when we talk about the first thing to go sometimes in these programs are music, the arts, and sports, but as we see, there's so many careers, so many lives that have been impacted by just a simple opportunity and allowing people to be able to do that. So congratulations for the great work that you do and Salvation Army is doing, Nicole. And then also to Akemy, wanted to wish you a very best too. You got your competition coming up. Just know that we'll be rooting for you too. And don't be too nervous. You got this. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you, guys.
All righty. Thank you. Well, I want to let you know, listen, if you want more information, you can visit the website, salvationarmyny.org, and then follow them on Instagram, and also it will be GNY Music Creative Arts. Don't go anywhere. We've got more show, more open, coming up right after this. We'll be right back.
When taking public transportation, don't touch your phone. Carry hand sanitizer and use it immediately upon leaving the bus or train. Avoid touching your face. If someone is coughing or sneezing, move away. Wash your hands with soap and water as soon as possible. Limit contact with poles. If possible, avoid rush hour. Don't eat or drink on public transportation. Keep your bag off the floor or other surfaces. Avoid directly touching turnstiles. Stay up to date with the latest from your local health department and CDC.
And we are back. Five for Five is a creative arts after school film program with a focus on content creation dedicated to engaging, educating, and inspiring young students. The program encourages students to connect, be empowered, and embrace the culture and the community around them. Joining us, telling us more details is the co-founders of Five for Five Films, Josh Raff and Jordan Battiste. And gentlemen, thank you for joining us. And when we talk about really engaging young people in the arts, I know this is something that you want to do and something that you have done. I'll let Josh go first. And tell us a little bit about why you decided this was so important.
Yeah, good to meet you. Good to have you. Good to be here. And thanks for having us. You know, it started in the Bronx as a volunteer effort. Jordan and I are content creators ourselves. We were in a band together, and then we created, started creating music videos and then film work. And we wound up volunteering, bringing a program to a school in the Bronx, High School for Law and Community Service up by Fordham. And just came once a week and just started writing stories with the students as an after-school effort and making short films with them, you know, really low stakes kind of stuff, but putting a camera in their hands and showing them some acting techniques and things like that. And the program grew over the course of the semester. And by the end, the principal became a friend and an ally, and he put us in touch with some of his colleagues. And the next semester, we were doing it in three schools. And then, you know, jump cut to right before COVID, we were in 10 schools. Wow. And everything shut down at that point, obviously. You know, on the other side of it, schools were reaching out to us to see if we were coming back. And we didn't know if that was going to be happening. But Jordan and I spoke at length. And we, you know, we feel like there's something that we have to give and to offer, and that the students that we work with get a lot out of the program. That, you know, it's really about the self-expression we found. You know, people have asked me, are these kids that are aspiring filmmakers? Do they want to go to film school? And as far as I'm concerned, maybe yes to some, but the majority, that's so far from their radar based on a lot of the environments that they're a part of, you know, outside of school, that we just want to keep them engaged in a program and allow them the opportunity to have a voice and create. And that's what our program really does.
So, Jordan, let me bring you in and talk a little bit more about the program. And you got an upcoming film festival. And talk to us about the film festival and what can we expect?
Yeah. The program obviously allows a lot of kids to be expressive. You know, this is an opportunity for them to create stories and you know, for them to embrace their vision for what creativity really looks like. And, you know, the film festival is an opportunity for us to celebrate them. You know, we're gonna have, we're gonna have a DJ, we're gonna have poets, we're gonna have live performances. You know, this is just a great opportunity for kids to really be celebrated. And, you know, we have a bunch of our different schools that are gonna be coming together in this space. So this is, you know, this is just a high point in our, in this program.
Yeah. For the kids that be able to have a space, right, it's important. And I think that we've said this a couple of times on this show. When you look at budgets in a school budget, first thing that gets cut sometimes is music, arts, and then also sports. But the way that you've been able to impact young people's lives, you can tell that there are some that really have a budding career in this and those that really want to make something out of this. So what's the message that you have for those people who may think, you know, hey, well, you know, they're just playing around with cameras and stuff? There's more to it than that.
Yeah. There is more to it than that. You just got to stay in it. You know, I mean, there's so many things out there in the world that's trying to detract from young people and keep us, you know, I mean, you know how crazy the world is now. I mean, there's so many negative things happening in social media. And, you know, this is just an opportunity for kids to stay creative, you know, stay in your vision. You know what I mean? Stay focused on what makes you happy. And hopefully this program is doing that for these young people.
Yeah. Josh, for yourself, seeing these young people take part in the film festival and the part of the film festival, what's it mean for you, given the fact that a lot of talent on display?
Yeah, for sure. You know, it's really great. We did this before COVID, and it's exciting that we're getting the chance to do it again. To see their reactions watching their work on the big screen is really what it's all about, you know, because sometimes it can be a little laborious on set, you know, and can be sitting around and not everyone's doing something at all times. But we try to find areas for all of our students to have an impact in a given film. And so then they get to watch that in front of others and watch the films be celebrated. You know, we're not submitting these for Academy Awards per se, but there's some great moments in them. There's some good acting moments. There's some good improvisational moments. There's some good director's choices, you know. And even the person, you know, if we do a hospital scene, for instance, and we are limited with our resources because everything's in school, we'll just write, you know, delivery room and a little sign in, from time to time, you know, really keep it simple. But that person's the props person and the set designer. And so they have a role in the film. So everything gets celebrated at the festival. It all comes together, and it's a great moment.
For someone who wants to know what it looks like, you know, in terms of the after-school program, in terms of curriculum and how you guys navigate, talk to me about the program itself and what could a student expect when they visit the after-school program?
You know, really what we try to practice is no experience necessary. You know, we encourage everyone to come, you know, from beginning to end, week over week, because then you'll develop a skill set. But if somebody wants to step in and stop by 5 weeks in, great, they're welcome. We start with a lot of different creative writing prompts and exercises that we then help the students develop into a storyline or a plot, and then from there into a script, and then from there into being on set and filming. And that's where the expertise of the instructors comes in. We're filmmakers at heart, and we have various skill sets of writing, production, you know, cinematography and editing, so that we can help guide these novice filmmakers to create a product from beginning to end.
Jordan, you get the last word.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. I mean, we've distilled our experiences from shooting films and movies to commercials to, you know, the different types of productions that we've collectively been on. We have brought those experiences and simplified them into a really simple experience for them to harness, to capture, and to understand really simply. You know, I mean, we've been on sets where there have been so many different moving parts, and I believe a young person can be very flustered if they were to see all the different mechanisms and roles and dynamics. This is just a really easy way for them to understand what's happening, for them to grasp it, to feel like it's possible, you know, that to feel how easy it is to be a director, to step up and be proud and be open and you know what I mean? And this is just a really easy and abbreviated way of seeing what the film set looks like. And they get it, you know what I mean? We move right along and they understand it right away.
Well, I want to thank you both for sharing. And listen, want to let people know the upcoming film festival is happening on June 14th from 3 to 5 at 500 East Fordham Road in the Bronx. That's going to be at the third floor library. And gentlemen, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you for having us, Daren. You're invited as well.
Thank you. And I want to tell the public, too, if you want more information, you can visit the website at 545films.com and then follow them on Instagram at 545_films. Well, we've come to the end of our show today. I want to thank all of our guests for joining us. And most of all, you, the viewer, for tuning in. And if you missed any part of today's show, you can always catch Recablecast on Optimum's Channel 67. If you have Verizon Files, that'd be Channel 2133, or watch us anytime on the web at bronxnet.org. If you're looking for a brand new episode, come back on Friday morning. My girl Rita Valentine will bring you the best of arts and entertainment. That about wraps it up for us on the set here of this particular open. I'm Daren Jaime, telling you make sure to keep this channel wide open. Take care. God bless.